Hello there, I'm Corel Painter Master Aaron Rutten, and in this video I'm going to show you what's new in Corel Painter 2016. So the first thing you'll notice when you launch Painter is there's this nice welcome screen. You can learn about the new features. If we look under Get Content, there's packs of brushes that you can download. So if you want a whole bunch of flame brushes or a whole bunch of fur brushes, you can download those. You just click on Buy Now. And then you can purchase the brushes directly from Corel Painter. They'll install as soon as you purchase them, and they'll be permanently installed in Painter. So even if you reset your workspace, those brushes are still going to be there. They will show up in their own category in your brush library. You can get started by creating a new image or doing other common tasks. There's also some common workspaces. So if you're new to Painter, you might prefer this workspace that highlights the basic features. If you want to see what new brushes are in Painter, you could select this workspace and so on. There's the Get Inspired tab, which you can cycle through to see some artwork by Corel Painter artists. I'm somewhere in here, right there. And then I have another image right here. So it's really cool to be included in this gallery. If you don't want to see this screen every time you start up Painter, just uncheck this box here. You can close the window here. And if you need to get that back, you can always go to Help. Welcome. So let's take a look at one of these new workspaces. Let's try New to Painter. That's going to rearrange all of the palettes in your workspace, and it's going to provide some options that are going to be really helpful to people who have never used Painter before, especially this Hints panel, which we'll talk about in a little bit. I'm just going to switch from the New to Painter workspace to my custom workspace, and then we'll take a look at some of the major new features in Corel Painter 2016. One of the changes that I like the most is the improvements to the blending. In older versions of Painter, if you were to use something like the Coarse Oily Blender or maybe Diffuse Blur, you'll get these light or white pixels on your edges of your blending. That happens if you're working on a layer that's separate from your canvas. But if I switch to one of these newer brushes that uses the newer version of blending, which we can take a look at here, there's a new blending palette which has replaced the Well palette. You can choose Enhanced Layer Blending. And you can use this on any of your pre-existing blenders to make it work more properly. So if I use this updated Coarse Oily Blender, you can see that I can blend and I don't get the white. If I use this Speckle Diffuse Blur, I can blend the edges here and I don't get the same white pixel effect that I get when I use the regular Diffuse Blur. Let's try this on a transparent background using something like Just Add Water, which has been updated to Enhanced Layer Blending. So you can see I'm not adding any white at all. It's just blending the transparency. If I were to turn that off, I'm going to add white, and you can see it adds white paint that covers up that transparency rather than blending with it. If we turn the black back on, you can see exactly what Enhanced Layer Blending is doing. It's making it blend as it should, which I am really happy about. Let's run through the features on the blending palette. We have some presets. If you want a particular look for your blender, you can switch quickly between these. You can play with settings for resaturation and bleed. And if you hover over each of these sliders, you're going to get some feedback that tells you what each of these options does. That's really helpful. You can add bleed. There's brush loading if you want to pick up existing color. And there's dry out, which controls how the blending works. So for this particular brush, there's kind of a medium amount of dry out, so the brush kind of fades out. Dry out to transparency ensures that it kind of has that nice natural tapering to the end of the stroke. Let's take a look at a new blending type, which is called Grainy Alpha Blend. So I'm going to use the blender that's called Grainy Water 2. And this picks up a little bit of grain, but when it blends to transparency a little bit better than some of the other technologies do. If you look under the general panel, you can see Grainy Alpha Blend. So if you're making your own custom blenders, you can definitely try this out. It works a little bit better than some of the other options. Picks up a lot of grain, but if you want less grain, you can obviously turn your paper texture down and then you don't get as much. It gives you some really, really natural looking blending results. The next major new feature that we'll take a look at is audio expression. You can now use audio input from your microphone, an instrument, or even music that you have playing on your computer to control the expressions of your brush strokes. So just like you can connect an expression for pen pressure to your brushes, you could now connect audio expression and you could speak into your microphone and control the size or color or direction of the brush. You can do a lot of really cool things with it. So let's take a look at how to do that. You're going to need to access your audio palette from the window menu. We want the audio settings panel, and by default, audio input's turned off, so you want to make sure it's turned on. You can select your input. If you're going to be using a microphone, like the microphone on your laptop, then you'd want to select microphone. If you're going to play music on your computer, you'd want to choose internal audio. Same goes for if you were going to connect this to like a keyboard or some other instrument. So this is the audio settings palette. Now, strength and range we'll play with in just a minute here. Let's go ahead and select an audio brush. You can go to the audio expressions category and choose some brushes. I'm going to choose a few custom brushes that I created here. So since I have this set to internal audio, if I go over here to Winamp, which I use to play MP3s, and I play this royalty-free MP3 by Jingle Punks, let's see what happens when I use this brush. You'll notice that on the drum beats, especially the louder ones, this particular brush expands and gets larger. Now, when you click on an audio brush, you're going to get this dialog. This is meant to help you use the brush and set the settings to the correct settings, because some music doesn't respond as well as other music does, especially classical music, because it doesn't have a lot of drums and bass like something like R&B would. So you can go ahead and read this if you want to get a feel for what the settings do. If you don't want to see this every time you select a brush, then you're going to want to check Do Not Show This Again. If you need to get it back, it's in the Preferences under General, and you just recheck the Show Using Audio Expression dialog box. We'll go ahead and start that music again, and let's take a look at this brush. I'm going to select a color, and you can see that while the music is kind of mellow, the brush isn't doing a whole lot. And if we look in this little decibel meter here, you can see that it's only moving a little bit in the green. We want it to be going nearly towards the end here. Green is showing that it's a good level, yellow will show that it's getting into too loud, and red is going to show that it's kind of getting cut off. So ideally you want it to be right in the yellow range, almost in red. So I'm going to turn up the strength, and you can see that that increases the strength of the audio input. So the brush is going to respond a little bit more aggressively to the changes in the music. Now, if you want to expand the range of that as far as how much of the music it's going to capture, is it going to capture the quiet parts, the loud parts, or everything? You can change the range. So I can decrease the range, and the brush is going to respond to pretty much everything in the music, or I can increase the range, and then it's going to just limit that to maybe the peaks in the audio. So you're going to get less of a response. So as I mentioned before, a lot of the brushes can be connected to audio. You want to look in the window menu and go ahead and open the brush control panels, general. That'll bring up all of your brush controls that are accessible. So let's say, for instance, we want to look at the brush size. We'll open that up. You can see that under expression, where there's normally pressure and direction and everything else, to the right of that is a little audio button, and you can check that to enable audio expression for the size. And you'll notice that that's on other things. For instance, if we look at color variability, there's color variability from audio input. So I think most everything that you could have an expression on for pressure and all of these other things, you can also have an expression for audio. So it's definitely worth experimenting with to see the different results that you get. The next major new feature we'll take a look at is dynamic speckles. And this is an entirely new type of brush. You can get really, really natural looking brush strokes now, because similar to the particle brushes, there are these little dots, these little speckles that follow your brush like a bristle would on a paintbrush. And you can control that in the dynamic speckles palette here. You can control the count. If you want more speckles, or if you want less speckles, you can reduce the count. If we reduce it really low, you can start to see each individual speckle. You can control the size of the speckles if you want them to be thinner. You can get some really interesting results from this brush. I mean, think about how well this will work for hair and grass and fur and all kinds of things. You get a lot of control out of this. You can control the size with pen pressure. You can also set that up to other expressions. And you can control the jitter, the randomness, smoothness, opacity, and all that stuff. So it's actually pretty cool. You can also play with the spacing if you want a more dotted look for your speckles. Like so. The next new feature we'll take a look at is the ability to rotate papers and flow maps. And this is really handy because sometimes when you're using these papers, let's use this pebble board for example. I'm going to increase the scale and the contrast, and I'm just going to add a little bit of texture. No matter where I paint, and even if I pick up my pen, I'm always going to get that same direction of that texture. And it gets a little boring. You can, of course, scale the size down a little bit, then you get a little bit of variance, but it's not quite enough. Now you can rotate the paper texture, so you can see it rotating around like so. So I can rotate, paint a little bit more, rotate a little bit more, and paint, and I get much more variety in that texture. It looks way more organic and not so repetitive. And just like papers, you can rotate flow maps as well. So if I'm painting with watercolor and I want to make my flows look a lot more organic, or even just change the direction of the drips as if I were rotating the paper while it were drying, I can do that by rotating the paper. I can overlap these and I can get a much more organic result. Another new feature that's been added is the ability to import stamps or dabs from Photoshop. So if there's brushes that you use in Photoshop that you want in Painter, you can now import those. If you want to import a Photoshop brush, you go to Brushes, Import, New from Photoshop Brush Stamps, and then you'd select that Photoshop Brush Stamp file. That'll import it into Painter, and it will be in its own little category here. And last but not least on my list of new features is the ability to mix special media like impasto, watercolor, particle liquid ink, and speckles. And so for instance, I have this brush here that I created that is called Liquid Ink Splats. This is a liquid ink brush that takes advantage of one of these new brush types, which is liquid ink flow particles. So I'm combining liquid ink and particle technology together. Now you can also combine particle technology with watercolor. You can connect the dynamic speckles with the particle technology, and there's even dynamic speckle bristle. There's thin lines gravity particle, thin lines flow particle. There's all kinds of new combinations of things that you can create here. Let's take a look at another example of combining some of these technologies. Let's go to the particle brush called Flow Fur. This is how it looks normally. And if we go to the impasto palette, let's change this from draw to color to draw to color in depth. And now we get this nice impasto effect along with our particle brush. Let's take a look at real watercolor. Here's a combination of real watercolor and speckle called Speckle Tiger Lily. Gives you some really interesting results. So I recommend you experiment with that to check out all the different combinations of brushes that you can create.